Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video, I'll be discussing on the anatomy of lateral wall of the nasal cavity. So these are the three pictures you can see showing the lateral wall of the nasal cavity in the bony framework, in the coronal section of the cadaveric dissection, and the third is the sagittal view of the cadaveric dissection showing the lateral wall of the nose. So you can see here the lateral wall of the nose is formed by the medial surface of the maxilla. So this is the maxillary sinus, and on the other way around you can say that the medial wall is the base on which the lateral wall of the nasal cavity is formed. So it is identified by the presence of the three prominent turbinates. So in the sagittal view we can nicely see the turbinates, and this is the bony framework of the nasal cavity. These are the two lateral wall of the nasal cavities. Now let us see the different parts of the lateral wall of the nasal cavity in sequential manner from anterior to posterior. The most anteriorly is located the vestibule. Just behind the vestibule is the area of the atrium, and the most posteriorly most placed is the area of the turbinates and the corresponding meatus. So you can see in the cadaveric dissection, sagittal section, this is the area of the vestibule, this area is the atrium, and the three turbinates. This area of the vestibule, it is identified by the presence of the hairs, and this area is lined by the skin. Just behind the vestibule lies the atrium. This atrium of the lateral wall of the nose, this area is lined by the mucosa. So you can see here, this is the atrium of the lateral wall of the nose, and it is devoid of any important prominent structures. Just behind the atrium lies the turbinates, or we call it concha also. There are three turbinates. This is the inferior turbinate, this is the inferior meatus, this is the middle turbinate. This is the area just beneath is the middle meatus and the superior turbinates. This is the area of the spinoethmoidal recess, and there are other few important anatomical relations which must be known. This is the presence of the agar nasi cells. This agar nasi cell, it is located just in front of the middle turbinate. So if you can see here, this is the area of the middle turbinate. This is the middle turbinate. And the soft tissue bulge, which is formed by, this is the area of the agar nasi cells. Then another important relation to be remembered is the guana. So you can see here, this is the guana. This is the area of the nasopharynx showing the eustachian tube. So just remember that the roof of the guana lies at the level of posterior end of the middle turbinate. If you see here, this is the middle turbinate, and it is at the level of the guana. And the eustachian tube opening, it lies in the nasopharynx at the level of posterior end of the inferior turbinate at around a distance of 1 cm. So just like the nasal septum, the lateral wall of the nose, it is formed by bones, cartilage, and soft tissues. But the major contribution of the lateral wall of the nose is by the bones. Now let us see the bones which contribute to the formation of the lateral wall. So these are, the main contribution is by the lamina papyracea of the lacrimal bone. Next is the contribution of the turbinates. These are the middle and the superior turbinate, which are the part of the ethmoid bone. Then the another contribution is by the inferior concha, or the inferior turbinate. Posteriorly, it is contributed by the two important bones, that is the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone and the medial pterygoid plate of the sphenoid bone. And if we see anteriorly, a little bit contribution is also given by the nasal bones and by the frontonasal process of maxilla. The cartilages which contribute to the formation of the lateral wall of the nose are the lateral process of the septal cartilage and the major and the minor alar cartilages. So the lateral wall of the nose is also known as the place of the conchas or the turbinates. So what are these turbinates or the conchas? They are the paired thin shelf-like bones which are covered with the adherent mucoperosteum that arises from the lateral wall and from the roof of the nasal cavities. There are three turbinates, inferior, middle, and the superior turbinates, and they divide the nasal cavities into four air channels. These air channels are the inferior meatus, middle meatus, superior meatus, and the sphenoethmoidal recess. Turbinates play a vital role in the physiology of the nose. So the most important function of the turbinate is to assist in maintaining the direction of the airflow and to maintain the laminar pattern of the airflow in the nasal cavity. Moreover, it contributes in the olfaction by directing the airs to the olfactory area of the nasal cavity. So we know that the olfactory area is localized only to the superior most part of the nasal cavity. So the turbinates, they direct the air in such a way that the air will reach this area. Moreover, they help in the air conditioning of the inspired air. That means they do the warming, humidification, and the filtering of the inspired air. Now let us discuss about the individual turbinates in detail. The first and foremost is the inferior turbinate. So remember, unlike the middle and the superior turbinate, inferior turbinate is not a part of ethmoid bone. It is a separate bone. So you can see here, this is the area of the inferior turbinate. It is a fairly straight bone that runs from the anterior to the posterior directions. Its inferior margin is free and it overhangs the meatus, that is called the inferior meatus. The superior margin of the inferior turbinate is attached to the anteriorly to the wall of maxilla and to the palatine bone posteriorly. There is one important duct which is present in the inferior meatus, that is the nasolacrimal duct. This nasolacrimal duct, it opens into the inferior meatus at about 1 centimeter behind the anterior end. So in this picture, you can see that the inferior turbinate is trimmed to show the inferior meatus, and this is the anterior end, and this is the opening of the nasolacrimal duct. This opening of the nasolacrimal duct is protected by one valve, which is called the Hasner's valve. So this is a schematic diagram showing the nasal cavity and the ostomedial complex. So this is the how the inferior turbinates, they hang from the lateral wall of the nasal cavity, and this is the inferior meatus. Middle turbinate, it is a part of the ethmoid bone. If you see here the coronal section of the cadaveric dissection, this is the middle turbinate. But this middle turbinate, it is not straight in configuration. Rather, it curves in different planes at different parts. So for the clinical purpose, we usually divide the turbinates into three parts. That is based on the how the middle turbinate is oriented. The anterior part, the middle part, and the posterior most part. And the plane of the turbinate is different in these individual parts. Now let us see the orientation of the anterior most or the first part. This part is oriented in the sagittal plane. If you see here, this is the middle turbinate. It is oriented in the sagittal plane. Here it is attached to the frontonasal process of maxilla. This is the middle turbinate. When it hangs like this, it is attached to this frontonasal process of maxilla and to the lateral lamella of the cribriform plate. So this is the area of the cribriform plate, which is a part of the ethmoid bone, and it is attaches to the lateral lamella of the cribriform plate. After running for a certain distance in the sagittal plane, this middle turbinate, it turns laterally, and then it is arranged in a coronal section, and it is attached to the lamina papyracea. So if you see the shape of the middle turbinate, it can be compared to the shape of a dried leaf. So this is the view how it looks from the middle meatus. And this is how the middle turbinate, if we are looking from the side of the septum, the turbinate, it looks like this. And you can see here, this is the first part, which is oriented in the sagittal plane. Then it turns laterally and it is attached to the lamina papyracea. And it is here in this second part, it is arranged in the coronal plane. Then in the third plane, it is in the horizontal axis. So this is the first part, This is the second, and the horizontal pattern is the third part. So when the first part, it turns lateral, and when it gets attached to the lamina papyracea, this section, it is in the coronal plane. And the area of the attachment of the middle turbinate to the lamina papyracea is called the basal or ground lamella. It is called so because it provides stability to the middle turbinate. This basal lamella is the bony mucosal junction. Actually, it divides the anterior and the posterior group of ethmoid cells. So if you see here, the middle turbinate is trimmed, and this is the point of attachment of the second part, and this is called the basal lamina. The third part, or the posteriormost part, is oriented in the horizontal plane. Then the middle turbinate, it runs in the horizontal plane. Here it runs along the lamina papyracea and the perpendicular plate of palatine bone. And the posterior end of the middle turbinate, it coincides with the roof of the choana. Now let's see the structures in the middle meatus. If we go in a sequential manner, we will see that in the anteriormost part, we will get the uncinate process. Posterior to the uncinate process lies the ethmoidal bulla, and the third important constituent of the middle meatus is the infundibulum. So you can see here a window is made in the middle turbinate to demonstrate the relations of the structures of the middle meatus. So if you see here, this is the middle turbinate. This thin bony projection is the uncinate. This bulbous projection is the bulla. The space between the uncinate and the bulla is called the hiatus semilunaris. And this hiatus semilunaris, it leads into a three-dimensional space called the infundibulum. Now let's see in the soft tissue specimen. This is the uncinate process. The bulla is being retracted here. The space between these two is the hiatus semilunaris. The infundibulum is the three-dimensional space that leads from the hiatus semilunaris. So if you see here, the coronal section of the middle meatus area, we can see here, this is the first part of the middle turbinate. This is the ethmoidal bulla. This is the uncinate process, and the groove or the ridge between the bulla and the uncinate is the hiatus semilunaris. It leads into a space called the infundibulum. So if we look into the coronal section of the CT scan, this is the middle turbinate. You can see this is the inferior turbinate. This is the uncinate bone. This is the area of the hiatus semilunaris on the both the sides. So when we are talking about the lateral wall of the nose, we must know what is the osteomyotal complex. Osteomyotal complex, remember, it is not an anatomical area, but it is a functional area where the maxillary sinus, anterior group of ethmoidal sinus, and the frontal sinus, they drain. This osteomyotal complex is formed by the uncinate process, which we have seen, the bulla and the intervening infundibulum. They all together, they form the osteomyotal complex. So this is the picture of the osteomyotal complex. If you look into the sagittal section of this lateral wall of the nose, you can see here, this is the area of the osteomyotal complex. This is the uncinate bone. This is the bulla. The bulla is the most prominent and the largest anterior ethmoidal cells. This is the hiatus semilunaris, which leads into a three-dimensional space called the infundibulum. Into the infundibulum, the frontal sinus, it drains, the maxillary sinus drains, and the anterior group of ethmoidal cells, it drains. So this is the importance of osteomyotal complex. So to understand the osteomyotal complex in a better way, we must know in details about the individual constituents of the osteomyotal complex. The most important is the uncinate process. This uncinate process, it is a sickle-shaped thin bone which is covered with mucosa. It is located most anteriorly in the middle meatus. It is attached superiorly. If you see here, this is the uncinate process which is attached superiorly to the lamina papyracea, and posteriorly it articulates with the inferior turbinate and the perpendicular plate of palatine bone. Its orientation also is not in a straight line. It is the orientation, it has three different parts. It is sickle shaped, so it has anterior part is it has a vertical limb. The middle part has the intermediate transitional limb, and the third most part is the horizontal in orientation. The intermediate transitional part, it covers the infundibulum. So while doing the functional endoscopic sinus surgery to expose the infundibulum, the uncinate is cut. The upper end, if you see here, the upper end of the uncinate, it lies within the frontal recess. And since the infundibulum is a common draining pathway for the frontal sinus, for the maxillary sinus and the anterior group of ethmoidal sinus, it is the attachment of the uncinate which determines the drainage of the frontal sinus. The next important constituent of the ostomedial complex is the ethmoidal bulla. The ethmoidal bulla is the most constant, the prominent, well-limitized anterior ethmoidal cells. So if you see here, the middle turbinate is being retracted. We can see this bony projection. This is the ethmoidal bulla. The ethmoidal bulla is limited posteriorly by the ground lamella of the middle turbinate. That is, when the middle turbinate, it turns laterally, and when it gets attached to the lamina papyracea, that is the limit of the ethmoidal bulla. Sometimes a space may exist between the bulla and the ground lamella. That space is called the retrobulbar space. In majority of the patients, in majority of the cases, the bulla may extends up to the skull base, but sometimes there may be a space above the bulla. Then it is called the suprabulbar recess. And sometimes these suprabulbar recess and the retrobulbar recess, they may communicate with each other. So we have seen the individual constituents of the ostomedial complex. Now let us see about the drainage of the sinuses in the infundibulum. So infundibulum is a three-dimensional space that leads from the hiatus sublunaris. At the anterior end of the infundibulum, the frontal sinus, it drains directly or indirectly into the frontal recess. The maxillary sinus, it drains into the infundibulum just inferior to the ethmoidal bulla. So you can see here, this is the area of the ethmoidal bulla, and this is the area of the hiatus sublunaris leading to the infundibulum. The maxillary sinus is drains just inferior to the opening of the ethmoidal bulla. So the relations of the maxillary sinus ostium, anteriorly lies the nasolacrimal duct, posteriorly lies the posterior fontanelle, inferiorly is the inferior turbinate, and superiorly is the lamina papyracea and the orbit. So we know that the frontal sinus, it drains into the infundibulum or it drains into the ostomedial complex. So the frontal sinus drains into the infundibulum directly or indirectly through the frontal recess. So this is the area of the frontal recess. The shape is hourglass shape. The drainage depends on the attachment of the uncinate. This is the uncinate bone, sickle shaped bone, the vertical limb, the intermediate limb, and the horizontal limb. The most anterior part of the uncinate process, the way of attachment determines the drainage of the frontal sinus. So the frontal recess boundaries anteriorly lies is the location of the agonizae cells and the uncinate process. Posteriorly is the bulla ethmoidalis. Lateral wall is formed by the lamina papyracea, and the medial wall is formed by the middle turbinate, which is trimmed in this diagram. Now let us see the different attachments of the uncinate bone. Most commonly, the uncinate process, it attached to the lamina papyracea. So in that case, the frontal sinus, it drains medial to the uncinate process. But sometimes some variations may exist in regard to the attachment of the uncinate process, and so the drainage of the frontal sinus also varies. Now let's see the different variations. This uncinate process sometimes can be attached to the skull base. This is the area of the skull base. It may be attached to the middle turbinate. Sometimes it may run forward and be attached to the insertion of the middle turbinate, and sometimes it may lie free within the middle meatus. So in this case, when the uncinate is attached to the skull base, the frontal sinus will drain lateral to the uncinate process. When it is attached to the middle turbinate, in that case also, the frontal sinus is draining lateral to the uncinate process. It model bulla may drain directly into the middle meatus, it may drain into the hiatus semilunaris, or it may drain into the sinus lateralis. That means with the sinus lateralis is when there is a retrobulbar recess and the suprabulbar recess, they combine together, they form the sinus lateralis. The maxillary sinus is always drains in the middle meatus. The sphenoid sinus, it drains into the sphenoidmodal recess. This ostium of the sphenoid sinus is located 1 to 1.5 cm above the roof of the corona. So this lateral wall of the nose is of utmost importance for the endoscopic sinus surgery of the nose. There are four lamellas which are encountered in the endoscopic surgery. So these four lamellas, the RD, the frontmost is the uncinate process. The second is the anterior wall of the ethmoidal bulla. The third is the ground lamella or the basal lamella, and the fourth lamella is the anterior wall of the sphenoid. Nasolacrimal duct, which connects the lacrimal sac with the nasal cavity, it opens into the inferior meatus at a distance of about 1 cm from the anterior end of the inferior turbinate. It is guarded by one valve called the Hasner's valve, and it lies 5 mm anterior to the normal maxillary ostium. Now let's see the blood supply of the lateral wall of the nose. It is more or less similar to the blood supply of the nasal septum. It gets its blood supply from both the external and the internal carotid system. From the internal carotid system, it is by the anterior ethmoidal arteries and by the posterior ethmoidal arteries. By the external carotid system, the main blood supply is by the sphenopalatine artery, posterior lateral branches of the sphenopalatine artery, superior labial artery, and the greater palatine arteries. The venous drainage of the lateral wall of the nose, it follows the arteries. The veins that follow arteries originating from the maxillary artery, they drain into the pterygoid plexus of veins, and the veins following the anterior region of the nasal cavity, they join the facial vein and they drain into the facial vein. From the superiormost part, they drain into the cavernous sinus, and sometimes the nasal vein in the foramen cecum may drain directly into the superior sagittal sinus. This is the diagram showing the nerve innervation of the lateral wall of the nose. So it is supplied by different nerves: anterior ethmoidal nerve, olfactory nerve is the nerve of olfaction, then the branches of the sphenopalatine ganglion, posteriorly also by the posterior superior lateral nasal nerve and the posterior inferior lateral nasal nerve. Anterior inferiorly, it is by the infraorbital nerve and by the nasal branch of the superior alveolar nerve. So this is about the anatomy of lateral wall of the nose. Thank you for watching this video.